using a different array of politics, but flipping that around a different array, I mean, these politics produce a different understanding of the urban age. I don't think the panel really kind of grappled with that kind of definitional, you know, what is the urban age itself? So my question to the panel would be, what does the politics you're describing tell us about the urban age, and particularly the urban age as a analytically, conceptually, political, useful frame to discuss politics rather than just this is politics at the current juncture? What is analytically significant about the urban age seen through the lens of the politics we're discussing?
Well, I can answer, I guess, of sorts, which is, you know, on one level, Lefebvre's hypothesis about the urban revolution was founded on the fact that we shift from society based on industrial production as the engine of our accumulation process to the city itself as a site of accumulation. Urban value drives the economy increasingly, as well as the urban is the primary place in which social experience life is produced. In that sense, this configures a different kind of politics in which we have to pay that strong attention to that extractive ambition of urban capital. But I think we've given ourselves far too much of an alibi by constantly blaming global capital, because it only lands as a main runway. So I think, you know, my not of the apocalyptic order of politics, which sometimes, you know, shifting circuits of capital investment can lead us to, you know, a sense of overpowering processes. But I think many of the capacities to shape some of these are in our hands, and we should take a look at it more closely. That's my answer. Is that okay?
I think. Might say that the politics of the urban age implies the politics of British academic urban studies as much as it implies the politics of the city itself. I suppose what I would gently try and suggest is that there is, I think urban studies at its best, I think, is a multidisciplinary engagement of people from very different scholarly traditions. At its worst, it can be a soapbox where people pay large sums of money and make claims. Stories that we tell sometimes might have fewer heroes, fewer black and white pictures, and more grays that's in them. And I think there is a politics we just heard. If you take the space outside, there's a rather more of a just space take on the space around King's Cross. But Rowan Moore made the argument that what we see outside in King's Cross is quite important and interesting trade-offs between public goods and private demands. And I think Andy and Jennifer, in a way, made reference to this in their contributions. There are some interesting things in terms of what art and development push back to Andy about, I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing if art is spent more money on culture than capital. How little capital is spent, there's no such thing as merry movies, right? But I mean, on a serious point, there are trade-offs that have been made.
Start engage with that and understand what is actually happening through those actions. notion of urban age, I don't know what that is meaning in a sense. I mean, obviously there are a number of projects that have been labelled with that, etc. It doesn't mean anything to me in terms of what we're looking at the current conjuncture, that's the word I'm what's happening now. Those notions of the so there was a transition point, and that would be the same in all places, or the opposite, I guess. I think what was more interesting is the issue of what is the nature of transformation of politics now, in cities, and trying to grasp that. I think we've not been served sometimes by the overgeneralization of theory or the abstraction of theory that misses out. I mean, just the things that Jane was mentioning, in a sense, is that we actually missed out many of the actors. But whilst we're talking about circuits of capital, we forget about the property development process and about the complexities of how property gets developed or anything, or decisions made. That's not to disappear into a mire of specificities, but we need to understand and theorise from that as much as anything else, to understand both how things are happening, but also where the possibilities of doing it otherwise are. Otherwise, we'd just like to sort of offer a counter-idealisation.
Two questions. One is, Andy mentioned this sort of reconfiguration of networks of governance from formal institutions to individuals, particularly in the cultural sector. And I wanted to ask him whether he thinks this is a problem, an opportunity. Could we eventually roll this back? There's nothing we can do about it. Might as well just learn how to deal with this new way of doing things. And the second one is, what, in your view, in the view of the panel, is the role of the old formal institutions, local governments specifically, in dealing with the disruptive effects of the technological innovations? And for instance, Airbnbs, who should be in charge, and how can we make these new innovations accountable?
Governance, and history for the
And that
itself as disruptive. I object to the whole notion anyway. It's a construction of a different form of organisation that needs to be taken on board in order to be able to govern it. You have to actually reconfigure your forms of governance. It's not that it's disruptive. That is always the case. So we must engage, to come back to the point about, we must engage with the actual existing institutions, change them, reform them, work through them, bend them in various ways to tactically address what are problems that those institutions were not made to be able to deal with. That's the process of a new construction. That's the way that I see how we engage, rather than this sort of what I see as almost like undergraduate lecture form of actually these are the mechanism of governance and these institutions that are way. They're not like that. The transformation is far more radical.
In terms of Nick's point about organisations that is the city corporation, I think that that's precisely the point that which one would say that the path of dependence is the city, our institution, the city corporation exemplifies precisely one of those path of dependencies because it structures the form of London through the lens of an institution that has 1,600 year history and sustains it. So it's not, it would be similarly the case that I think that one would say the Duke of Westminster actually created a land use pattern which, through the constructive use of leasehold, has made the Duke of Westminster still one of the richest people on the planet. It also creates a propensity in London to change in ways in which some cities have surrendered, right? Because leasehold creates a particular legal relationship between private interest and public good, which, coming on to the second point, then actually open up a particular space for law and governance and local government specifically, I think. If I was to push Jenny's point, I was trying to be controversial. I suppose the part of what I would say is that there was something in what Jenny said which I strongly agreed with, which is that the state becomes everywhere, right? Because the trade-offs between value capture are as much for the publics that are benefiting from the value that is captured as they are for the privates that are extracting profit. Right? To have one teases out those tensions is about thinking about how development control law sits alongside planning policy, sits alongside government. I think there is still an understated understanding in the United Kingdom, at least, as to the power of development control processes and planning processes to shape that landscape, even if you're in the Duke of Westminster. But it sits, and this is the final point of the relations, it sits in an unequal relationship with a central state, which if it acid strips local government and impoverishes local government to such an extent that you also find in London right here, right now, a sense in which local governments have been so pauperized that you put alongside the pauperization of the local state something like a new homes incentive, which means that local governments are giving targets through which they get money for the number of homes, public or private, that they build. And right now, if you look at the DCLG most recent statistics, London boroughs of Hackney and Tower Hamlets, as far as I know well, actually gets more from one borough in London in the new homes incentive than the whole city of Birmingham, because of the densification processes that Jenny has outlined. It's worth looking at the London, because quite clearly the new homes incentive replicates and amplifies land use value and produces a certain kind of innate densification based on central state relations to local. So I think there is both ambivalence about the propensity of local government to actually achieve things, and local city government in the United Kingdom to achieve things, but within a context of a fiscal control of city government that is still more centralised than pretty much any, well, the vast majority of other parts of the world.
Yeah, I think that's really in the zone that I'm trying to think about. And I guess if we think about the initial point in this round about the sort of long history of institutions and the past ends, so I would really want to open that up, not just think about institutions, but about the discourses and practices that shape the horizon of what is done, what can be done within the city. So it's just strange to me to start looking at these very bad little maps in London maps, you know, which have a long continuity, but then some breaks, so things change. And I think that's in a way that one, you know, and it's, I think Michael is hinting at, and along with the work of Yoda and Sue, a sort of new, a new moment in which the urban understands the urban being reconfigured. So we shouldn't suppose it has to be the same all the time. But what we have to suppose is that we do or don't have what's going on. So I think the past dependency of the planning imagination of the practices of development, the development model was very long-standing development. Why did it work out like this? Why did we have that kind of institution? It's dysfunctional. Everybody just about believes it. Tony travels to the mayor, the last one, the present one. I mean, it doesn't work. So how can one reconfigure both the spatial interventions? What kind of spatial form should that have? It's not in question, it's not being discussed. There's no coherent imagination of what kind of an urban form that would have. Top-marked developments where we can grab the money. Great. That's not very, very helpful. And if you're thinking also about the financing situation, then how do you restructure the allocation and distribution of land value taxing so that it can be used appropriately and sensibly and for the public good? At the moment, it's not working to put a little line around an area and say, fund yourself. Bad model. There's lots of other models around. So I think on the one hand, I would, you know, so looking at that long durée, but how did the current era of development get instantiated? Well, there's some interesting shifts in international urban policy, so sustainable development, Agenda 21, etc. These things came along and changed what the land planning process was and how the city as a whole was being thought about in planning terms, as did the wonderful concept of global city, which I think emerged in a policy era before it emerged in a theoretical mode. And started to reshape the imagination of what London was and what was going, as did the fundamental shifts in the economy of the city. So these things instantiated the current horizon of development, about the timing of London's turnaround and the population growth, the new horizon, a new amalgam of different things that shape the agenda. And I would say that the thing about thinking the urban is not straightforward. It's a very messy and complicated system in which it's really hard to discern what is shaping the outcome. Why is it happening like this? Not completely obvious, you know, this is the characteristic of the urban. So we all have to think harder, be more optimistic, as well as discerning the problems of the present, I would say.
Hi. I found the discussion really, really interesting. I'd like you to think a bit more about why is it happening like this? Because it seems to me that a number of loaded terms have been used. So, are we making compromises, or are we conceding? In the public realm is ceasing to exist, and we say that is a compromise. Well, is it? I'm not sure. Andy, you mentioned, and this is a direct quote from you, big data only works with existing taxonomies. If that's true, and I'm not sure it is, but if that is true, then it probably explains why the big tech companies are pushing for AI. And loads of you have mentioned data, and none of you have mentioned AI. And in most of the conferences I go to, we're all getting a bit bored with AI. But it seems to me that the thing I thought really interesting about what Michael said is this idea that we need to look more across disciplines in order to understand what is happening. And that happens so seldom. And it's the same thing that Andy mentions, the sort of the transferal of this stuff, you know, the kind of lateral transfer of this sort of thinking. So I think what, if someone wants to have a bit more of a go, why is it happening like this? You know, why does Google and YouTube move down the road? Did they move that because the space was created for them? Or did they insist that the space was created for them to move into? And there's one thing that does change really slowly, which is the grid streams. You know, look at the City of London. The street grid is pretty much the same as it was in the Great Fire, and the buildings are in the same sort of blocks, they just go up a lot bigger. So there is something permanent that is not path-dependent about some structures in the cities. And I don't know, I wonder whether they have an impact, do they help, do they hinder? And do they help us understand why it's happening like it is now?
Just respond to the taxonomy issue. issue that they're getting at, particularly there, is not disputing what AI can do, but where does the data come from?
Yeah.
Yeah? The data is produced from some rather specific places and through specific taxonomies, and you can't reconstruct those taxonomies by, you can reconstruct by putting them together with others, but you can't break them down fundamentally, yeah, because that was the data unit. And that's the problem that is both accepted and then made invisible in a sense, as though this was the raw stuff of life that AI will then put together to solve any particular problems or whatever. So that's the point I'm making, and I think that is very a fundamental lens, in which is a historical lens, because the production of census is, and the taxonomies that they used were about seeing the city in a particular way, seeing people in a particular way, and seeing dividing them into groups in a particular way. And that's why I'm talking about economic activity, etc. I mean, it's very difficult to then escape from those fundamental assumptions and then rethink those relationships. And that's why the transversal often is about a tactic of trying to take another routeway through how things are operating, and to understand them, which will then throw up different ways of intervening, challenging with them. But we have to acknowledge that there are some producing elements that have produced some structural components.
Does this should bring me full history of Trafalgar Square and biotechnologists about 15 years ago, where he makes the point that this iconic site of dissent, protest, and public display has never been pure or free. In all public spaces, do you think people avoid nostalgia in public spaces or parts? And you're thinking about Trafalgar Square, the 1870s regulated by forms of law, police, control, suppression of dissent, or if you're thinking of Bricklayer in the 1970s where certain kinds of public space are mediated by intense forms of racism and racist violence. In the public realm has never been quite as idealistic in the past, right? So I think I would say an answer to one question there. I think concessions and trade-offs are ubiquitous in time and in geographies, but they are not here. We make our Faustian deals through different currencies at different moments in history in that respect. So we need to be careful about the nostalgia of the past, as well as a kind of sloppy being, but not say a kind of simplistic question of what's happening in a space out here. Is there a law that has been there before? Far as where much as it is margins, property portfolio. Today, I think, but and which is why I think I just strongly support the point on I'm trying to mention kind of offensive machine learning to generate different kinds of configuration of data. But the one point I think is the reservation, the boundary point is that by definition the data is always limited by what is measured. So the question always becomes, where is the boundary between what is measurable and what is unmeasurable, and what are the devices that make the measurable visible? And I think that is productive and challenging rather than hubristic. And I think that opens up different kinds of conversation, or should open up different kinds of conversation, rather than leading to a fairly sterile determinism.
But I guess, I mean, it goes back a little bit to the multiplicity of actors involved in shaping the urban and outcomes that we live with, and that these might be, you know, circulating around the globe or highly localized actors, and in fact, it's hard to determine that configuration. I think a lot of apparently global circulating investments have to be imaginative themselves and embed themselves incredibly locally to be successful in any way. At the same time, the things that we live with as a form, which feels very unique or familiar, is so often completely repeated all around the world. So we live with these complexities. And I think also, I take very well the point that Michael was making and that Annie's case is displayed to us, is the range of people involved in making our built environments. I have many agendas about them. So I would say developers, planners, architects, frequently want to produce the best place, a place that people will love to come to, that will do their reputation every good. But sometimes a developer or a housing association or a municipality might have certain constraints which lead to a certain physical form and outcome which bears in it the traces of the way in which the land value capture has been orchestrated. And so we live then with that form. So we, you know, it's, I think we can get very frustrated with the kind of future that the city's making, but kind of unpack that and think, well, how can we organize this differently so we can realize the best hopes of the developer and the best dreams of the architect and the philanthropic contributions of communities who go to endless meetings to try and influence outcomes for their great grandchildren. There's amazing generosity of spirit around participation in the city form of 20 years of time. So I think in that bundle, it's really hard to say. Did they want it like this or did we? You know, I think this is a very complicated zone. And I think that your studies hopefully illuminate some of that for us.
Yes, I mean, you see, I guess the geographical differences is very challenging for us because what we assume as something normal or democratic in Europe happens completely different in Asia. But it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen rightly or how it should happen there. So, yeah, the rules of governance are very complex. So.
In this sense, I would like to add something because focusing on the national and state level, but I mentioned because it was about the scale, but they can scale down also the analysis. And when someone mentioned the Airbnb, we have a very clear example in Barcelona at the moment. It's why I think that we are missing, I mean, in terms of looking for alternatives, I think that there is a big correlation between the way in which some smart city projects, mainly Europe, are looking for alternatives, and it's the correlation between the technopolitics of data that was Michael was trying to say, and in my opinion, devolution. I mean, how Barcelona, for example, are trying to find different kind of policies, urban policies at the city level with the tourism, for example. But also Amsterdam, or for example, Dublin, the way in which academia are working, they are working together with the private sector, with the multinational, the SMEs, and the city government. I mean, I think that there are alternatives in this sense. And for me, answering to the question about what's the politics at the urban level, and maybe I mentioned, I started the analysis from the nation state, but we can scale down, and I think that there are already some kind of alternatives, at least in Europe.
I think part of what we're talking about is a politics of the future, of not of a politics that is in the future, but a politics of how we think about the future. And I'm very struck by the tactics of using scenario building that has been a tactic to try to avoid a fallback into a technocratic delimited set of argumentation that, of course, the technocratic modality of planning is to remove politics. So that's the erasure of the politics. So the opening up of possibilities of diversities in terms of different visions, I think, is a strategic intervention rather than all the rhetoric that we've seen of planning through all the planning documentation, the use of maps, the use of graphs, all these sorts of things.
give us a sense of a certainty and also a teleological sort of process, whereas actually developing other things. And this is what was a central point. If you take a very local example of the planning system, what has happened in this reconfiguration of the state is the planning system focuses on development control. There is no future invariably apart from more incremental development controls. And therefore this impoverished and also deracinated idea of being able to grasp futures or decide about futures or contest futures, I think has been removed both as a human capacity in actually real jobs, real people. Planning departments have been stripped of that sort of activity, and likewise most increasingly departments of government that focus on those sort of areas. The ghost science foresight problem thing is an exception to this in many senses. But I think it's, to come back to centering what I was trying to say, it's about how we think of the technologies and how to think of the future technologies in that sense, about the ideas, the concepts, the ways of grasping what the future is also linked up with everything about the present.
In fact, projects in the future is in place to end where we start. And the witching hour and the promises of trains forever. Before the sun goes down. I think it loops it back again. And I think it loops it back, and I'm really glad that the conversations have steered quite a bit of projects of knowledge and knowing the urban environment and technology. And certainly something that's quite crucial for most of the work we do in the lab, and since there's more and more crucial for the politics of the politics of the urban age, whatever the urban age means. But if you can join me in thanking a really rich and chatty panel, which is always very helpful. And thanks everyone for coming. This brings us